and welcome once again to another edition of Community Cop, where truth and real talk occurs. My name is Noel Leader, one of the co-founding members of 100 Blacks in Law Enforcement Who Care. I'm here today with a full panel, my three co-hosts. First of all, Julian Harper.
Welcome, welcome.
Second of all, Michael Graves, a.k.a. Big Mike.
Namaste.
And of course, the great Father Lucas.
Oh, tap.
And unfortunately, Orton Maddox is on Community Cop assignment. He won't be with us. He's been our guest consistently for a few weeks, but we'll miss him today, but he'll be back shortly, hopefully. And we'd like to welcome you, our viewing audience, once again to another, what we hope to be another informative program. We'd like to remind you and invite you to communicate with us via our Facebook page. Just punch on Facebook and look up Community Cop. Or if you want to call our hotline of 100 Blacks in Law Enforcement Who Care, 718-455-9059. Before we begin our program, we'd like to remind you, as we will the next few weeks, of an exciting event that's coming up and that is organized by our own producer, Veronica Kitt. The People's Film Festival will occur between May 30th and June 2nd, 2013. It's going to take place at the Harlem Theater, Johnson Theater on 124th Street and 8th Avenue. And there's an exciting film that this event is going to open with, by Phillips Nang, on the life of Toussaint Louverture, the Haitian revolutionary. And that's going to occur Thursday, May 30th at the Magic Johnson Theaters. That's located at 2309 Frederick Douglass Boulevard. And we'd like to welcome all of you to this great event. We're going to announce it again for those who didn't have their pen and pencils ready. It's going to be an extraordinary event, and we really commend our producers, Veronica Kitt, for putting this together. This is the People's Film Festival. It's going to take place in our community. A whole lot of independent films are going to be shown, so we encourage you to support this event. As I stated at the end of the program, we'll announce it once again. But as is customary on Community Cop, we like to reflect on some great events and individuals in our community that contributed to our history. Michael, why don't you remind our audience about two greats. First of all, Martin Delaney, and of course, the great Booker T. Washington, who recently had birthdays.
Well, yes, in the last couple of days, we've had two historic birthdays. One Sunday was Booker T's birthday, and certainly Booker T was the voice at one time of Black America. Certainly he's known for the leaving the great institution, Tuskegee Institute. Yes, there were questions around what type of leadership, and yes, he had the great debates with his contemporaries, but certainly he was a great leader in his own right. And while some might question, like, again, some of the things he did, you have to look at his contribution, and his contribution was as great as anyone's contribution in our history.
All right. Going straight, fast forward into
Martin Delaney.
Go ahead, brother.
Oh, I thought it was somebody wanted to comment on Booker T. But with respect to Martin Delaney, who was, I would dare say, one of the baddest Black men ever in our history. Martin Delaney was the man. Some might be more familiar with Frederick Douglass, Monroe Trotter, and certainly others. But for the record, in my humble opinion, I think he was the baddest of his era and maybe the baddest of all time. With respect to Marcus Garvey and Adam Clayton Powell, I think Martin Delaney was the baddest. And I'll just say one thing. With respect to the Dred Scott decision, these were his words when he was informed about the Dred Scott decision. It'll give you an idea into the character of Martin Delaney.
Now, he said, to remind the audience what the judge decided in the decision.
Well, in the decision, I mean, it was among other things, obviously, Justice Taney said that a Negro has no rights that a Black man, a white man is bound to respect. Mm-hmm. That was the statement that most people are familiar with. Justice Taney did that, who was in charge of the Supreme Court during that time. And but what he said, impacted obviously the entire nation, even the so-called free states. And when that information was given to Martin Delaney, this was his response to it. "Sir, my house is my castle. If any man approaches that house in search of a slave, I care not who he may be, whether constable or sheriff, magistrate, or even the judge of the Supreme Court. If he crosses the threshold of my door and I do not lay him a lifeless corpse at my feet, I hope the grave may refuse my body a resting place. Mm. This is what he said, because what he was saying was, if a slave gets in my house, he's in a safe house, and I will comfort and protect him. And obviously, you know, the Dred Scott decision, it said in it that, you know, you can't house, you can't in any way participate in a so-called runaway slave. And if you do, obviously, there was going to be penalties. So when he heard that information, he made it clear that anybody gets to my house, they safe. And any white man that crosses his door, knocks on the door to question him about a so-called runaway slave, he said if he doesn't lay him a lifeless corpse, irrespective of what his station in life is, he said, may the grave refuse me a resting place. You can't get better than that.
And what year was that approximately?
He did that in 1857.
1857. All right. Thank you, brother, for that information. And that had to be a bad brother to make that public announcement in spite of the overwhelming oppression and the lack of protection that blacks receive from, you know, as you quoted, the judge of the Supreme Court of the United States of America. Tell you. All right. Current information. This week it was reported that Israel, on a few days, sent some bombs into the independent nation of Syria, unprovoked attack that received little to no criticism by, you know, that we're aware of, the international community. Definitely no criticism by the United States of America. I can only imagine if Syria had set bombs into Israel. Now, of course, Israel attempt to justify this unjustifiable act or declaration of war by claiming they didn't want Syria to hand weapons to the militants or chemical weapons. You know, they like to throw that word in there, even though Israel used chemical weapons against Palestine, is in possession of chemical weapons. Julian, are you surprised? First of all, not only the arrogance of Israel or the illegal activity of Israel by bombing an independent nation, which is it amounts to a declaration of war. We can only imagine somebody bombing our country. But the lack of criticism, the lack of appropriate commentary on this aggression, this unnecessary aggression.
No, I'm not surprised. And I think that we have to really keep our eyes and our ears open to what the overall response to what's going on in Syria is going to be by this country and by the United Nations and other nations who are watching this all take place. You know, it seems as if that Israel can do no wrong. You know, whatever you see that's being conducted by Israel, they are getting support by the United States and by the rest of the West. So when you hear things such as this, to be surprised should not be one of your responses. It will definitely not be mine.
I find it very interesting, the spin that's being put on in the United States press. There have been criticism, by the way, but not in the official presses of most of those countries.
Right.
And the United States has go back to when President Obama made that silly statement about the red line. And what you have people like Braindead McCain and a couple of other Republican senators, they're trying to force the United States into this thing in Syria, too. And they're saying that when Obama made that statement, and if he doesn't live up to that statement, then a lot of other countries around the world who are supporting the United States are going to feel that when the crap hits the fan, the United States is going to back off, and so we might as well start getting our nuclear weapons together too. Now, to make that the spin, and that's the discussion, is to completely ignore the fact that what Israel did is totally illegal by international law. It's totally illegal by the Constitution of the United States. You cannot bomb, at least that's what it says, a country without serious provocation. And nobody's talking about the illegality of the act, but that the fact that President Obama may be called chicken if he doesn't respond. Mm.
And of course, the line you talk about, John, when President Obama said to the president of Syria that he cannot use chemical weapons against his citizens, and there's been some allegation that it was used, even though it's not even, it hasn't even been proven that, first of all, chemical weapons were used or that he used them. It could have been the rebels.
The rebels used them.
Right.
And there's no evidence at this point that will substantiate the fact that chemical weapons were used. Right.
Michael, you know, it's just, you know, it's really the muscle of a white supremacist state, because we know that if a non-white country sent bombs unprovoked into a white country, be it Europe or Israel or any European country, that the international from the Europeans' response would be enormous. Here you have a nation sending unprovoked bombs, murdering their citizens into a country, and the response is really no response. And you know, that's why it's very important to listen to the language of, as you stated, all of these apologists, but the way they spin it, you know, and misinform the public as to the illegality of what Israel actually did. There's no justification in it whatsoever. The Barack Obama administration hasn't responded appropriately, and I don't expect the white media to respond appropriately. But what are some of your reflections on Israel's allegation or claim about Syria and having chemical weapons, and, you know, even though they're in possession of chemical weapons?
Well, certainly, it's a salient point with respect to Israel and how you juxtapose that with the white supremacists in this country, because when you consider the fact that these are transplanted Europeans in the so-called Middle East, that they do not have a right to a blade of grass in Syria, they have no connection at all and have no history with other surrounding so-called Arab nations, and yet somehow they use the flimsy excuse to bomb Syria that they are bombing their own people. Now, I've never heard of any Israeli government under any regime be concerned about an Arab killing another Arab. So where is this concern coming from that an Arab cares about the killing of another Arab when during a Muslim prayer service, when that Israeli killed Arabs at that service, he said, and some leadership had reflected the fact that the thumb of an Israeli is more valuable than 10,000 Arabs. So the fact of the matter is, it is bogus when you look at it. If you can send bombs into that country, when you can raise questions about chemical weapons, who is the leader in making and producing chemical weapons? America. Who sells more chemical weapons to other countries than anyone else? America. Now, when you also consider the fact that Israel is killing scientists in other countries, sending hit teams in there, killing them, you know, so it is the height of hypocrisy. And I agree with your context when you talked about white supremacists. White supremacy is all part of white supremacy, not only being transplanted Europeans, but the fact is, if Zimbabwe wanted to deal with whites in its country, if South Africa or any of those countries that was colonized by whites wanted to extricate all the whites out of their country, they would have a problem with America. America would send NATO forces. They would be at the head of it, but they would send NATO forces. Now you almost look at Israel as a part of NATO, and they are not a part of the North Atlantic, you know, whole geographically, but the fact of the matter is, it's complicated because racism reigns supreme, and they kill Arabs ad nauseum, and at the same time, they fake like they're concerned about Arabs killing other Arabs, which makes no sense.
It's very interesting, too. A couple of other points that might come up. When you speak about NATO, of course, that's a joke. NATO is simply the fig leaf for the United States. When you talk about Israel, wasn't pushing that killing their own people as much as they're saying they want to prevent Syria from sending weapons to Hezbollah, and that they have a right to do that, which is absolute preposterous nonsense. And when you talk about killing your own people, could you imagine if China, after Kent State, for example, after the move in Philadelphia, when the United States killed their own people, mm-hmm. could you imagine if China had jumped in and started bombing the United States and say, you're killing your own people? Right. What would right.
And
it's crazy.
You know, when you look at the language that they use against the so-called rebels in Syria, you know, they never describe members of the Black Panther Party as rebels, you know, or the Black Liberation Army, who was fighting to preserve the rights of African Americans, as rebels, you know. So, you know, the words are very important. And Michael, to your point as it relates to Israel, Israel was the biggest supporter of South Africa, of white supremacist South Africa, of apartheid South Africa with Armitage. They gave them the bomb. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's just a very unfortunate set of circumstances. And I know that at the end of the day, as we close out on this particular issue, Israel sees that there's a skirmish, a war going on within Syria. Their objective is to further weaken the Syria government by bombing them. And the United States, the West, and Israel, their whole objective is to weaken that whole region. That's why they murdered heads of states. And after they murdered the heads of state, like in Iraq, there's confusion, there's death. They did the same thing in Libya. We see what's going on now in Libya. They've done the same thing in Egypt. There's confusion. So you had stable governments in this region at one time, regardless of their political affiliations, whether you agreed or disagreed with them. But it's the objective of the United States, Israel, and the West to make the governments in that particular region totally unstable and cause confusion because they benefit, as they do with the confusion of African Americans in this country. Topic number two, talking about the federal government. The federal government has just named Assata Shakur, or defined Assata Shakur, excuse me, as a terrorist, which, you know, really opens up the door for her to be assassinated. They've issued a $2 million bounty for her, wanted dead or alive. Michael Graves.
Well, certainly, so-called, formerly known as Joanne Chesimard, is now on the most wanted terrorist hit list. I didn't know when she became a terrorist, but I guess it's happened. They didn't name Static, who drove a plane into a federal building in Texas. They didn't name him a terrorist, but certainly whites can't be considered terrorists, irrespective of what they do. Assata Shakur was a victim of the counterintelligence program under Hoover. Now, you might say, well, Hoover had passed by the time she was arrested, but the fact of the matter is, in 79, that whole structure of the FBI, which still exists to this day, was built by Hoover, J. Edgar Hoover, and certainly the counterintelligence program, which was his baby, was still in effect in 1979 when she was arrested. And the fact of the matter is, not only did it preclude any justice in a courtroom, and obviously FBI working with local police departments, killing, disrupting, abusing civil rights organizations that were black, black liberation type organizations, black empowerment organizations, even churches, community groups, that, you know, the stretch of J. Edgar Hoover's counterintelligence program was far and deep, and she was a victim of that, and certainly she didn't have a just day in court, and she was found guilty. So those individuals who was able to get out of a minimum security jail, and she was able, obviously, to flee the country after years in so-called safe houses, to this day, I would say that certainly she is a symbol of resistance to tyranny from this American government. So she's to be saluted.
And one of the things we need to talk about is the duplicity in the justice system that causes someone to not receive a fair trial, not to have an opportunity to have their case brought before the courts in a fair manner. This duplicity in our government has failed our community and continues to fail our community, but unfortunately, because we don't have the political strength, the elected officials to address this duplicity in our government, the failing government and the justice system is failing our community. That's why we end up with cases such as this, and that's why they're capable of putting someone like her on the most wanted list for the FBI without having a fair and due process when we talk about this failing justice system. And because of, as Michael spoke about COINTEL, that has attacked so many black groups that attempted to assist our community in this overwhelming attack.
It's very interesting, you know, when we say the federal government, the FBI could put her on the most wanted list. But the designation of a terrorist, we got to go right back to it. That, as Bush said, I am the decider. The decider in this country, they're given the power for the President of the United States, President Obama, who has designated her as a terrorist. And I'm not so sure whether this is not part of that militarism and imperialism, that this may be an attempt to justify either a drone killing in Cuba or an attack on Cuba itself, since that Raul has not kowtowed to what the United States was hoping after he took power over Fidel. So that this thing is diabolical from A to Z, and of course under the leadership of the president that looks like Assad. And I'm wondering whether those of us who went in Cuba had visited with Assad, whether everybody who visited Assad may not be designated terrorists too.
Mm. Right. And when you look at the activity, and like I said, language and definition is very important, one of the greatest tools utilized by the white supremacists. You know, who determines or defines who a terrorist is? You know, Barack Obama, a couple of weeks ago, sent drone planes into Yemen and murdered about 13 innocent women and children. Is that, that's a terrorist act. I believe her relatives would say that was a terroristic act. But he has put a bounty on her head of $2 million, and I think it's very unfortunate. Any closing comments?
Well, just to remind that bombing in Yemen killed 46 people. 20 of them were women and 16 were children.
Right.
Well, one of the things we got to remember, when you make the definition of what a terrorism, you're not going to turn those words on yourself. So you're I'm not surprised the United States is not calling any of the works that they're doing as terrorist attacks.
Right. And it's not even debatable that some of the acts of this administration has been caused terror on other individuals. Issue number three. This week, another political official in our community have went down. This time is Senator Sampson, who was found guilty, who was indicted by the federal government. You know, it's apparent that the federal government has once again utilized individuals to wear wires. What's the sister who pleaded guilty and wore the wire in this latest group?
Her name was Cruz.
Anyway,
she was a state senator.
Right, and she pled guilty to some kind of embezzlement charge. But Father, we'll start off with you. Are you surprised at this later indictment?
No, and the majority of them indicted so far are people of color, which is rather interesting. And but nobody ever, you know, the bribery part of this. But in his case, it's supposed to be embezzlement and taking money in order to enable this dude to get that place out in Brooklyn. But in either case, nobody talks about bribery when Mayor Bloombox is able to buy off the city council in order to suspend the law so he could run for mayor for a third term in spite of the law that says two terms is the limit. Mm-hmm. I mean, so bribery, the whole government is run on bribery, if you look at it. Mm-hmm. The so-called lobbyists, what is that? Exactly. You know, it's ridiculous. Mm-hmm.
You know, when you talk about the malfeasance in government, you know, unfortunately, you know, the policing of it is, they do it by picking and choosing who they want to arrest, who they want to investigate, who's going to be indicted for the embezzlement, as you just stated, Father Lucas. You know, he's also been charged with lying to investigators and obstructing of justice. And the statement that they made, that they said he made, is kind of, you know, ambiguous. You know, you can't really tell what he really meant if he, in fact, made the statement. I believe it was, let's find out who's investigating us so we can take them out. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know what that means. I don't know whether that means to someone's demise, whether we can, well, I'm going to give information on them and they're going to we're going to take them out. So I don't know what that means. But you really have to look at how they utilize, as you state all the time, Noel, how they utilize words and how they pick and choose who's going to be investigated and what information is going to be utilized to either arrest or remove certain people from state and city government.
Well, certainly this process is far from objective. It's a form of cherry picking, and I don't think it's accidental that at one time, as the state majority leader, Senate majority leader, he was in a position to be one of the three men in the room to sit over the budget, New York State's budget. So that's not accidental. I think that this had more to do with his private law practice. They're saying that he took money from estates, from, you know, people who were not, you know, conscious of it, and he did some things to fleece in excess of $400,000. That had nothing to do with him as an elected official. That was his private practice. But I think it's not accidental. No, he had something. He was charged with other things in his with funding in his public office. Mm-hmm. But the majority of the money that they claim that he embezzled was from his private practice.
Yeah.
So I'm just saying. So I think in the young the female who admitted her guilt and wore wire over the last 3 years, it only shows you that the government cherry picks. They're directing people because they know elected officials are so dirty across the board that they're going to pick and choose who they're going to come down on. And once they get you, they got you. Once you're there, they're going to use you and target whoever they want to target, put you in significant conversations with them, extract that information, and then decide who they're going to go after. So this is not coming from the state. It's not coming from the city. It's coming from the feds. And the people happen to be of color, black, whether it's Stevens, whether it's Sampson, you know, and Seabrook and all of them. I'm just saying that it's the feds and they coming in. And the thing is, they're targeting certain people. And you always have to ask why.
Hmm. Now, Father, I'm sorry. Okay. One of the things when you say about the government, the very nature of this political system is what these cats are accused of doing. I mean, you make promises to people who donate money to your campaign, you know, whether it's under the table or over the table. Michael Bloomberg, I'm pretty sure, has done it. All these politicians do it. Cynthia Quinn, who's the Speaker of the House, people who support her, vote for her, she blesses Christine Quinn. She blesses them with chairmanship seats. She blessed their districts with more money. This political system, by nature, is corrupt. You know, now, some people may, go a little degree or two to the left or to the right, but that's how this political system works. You know, you solicit people's support, people support your campaign and with money because they believe they're going to get something out of it. That's from federal government, from state government, from city government.
And just respect to why is even when they had Reverend Sharpton, who wore wire in excess of 5 years for the federal government, some say up to 7 years, but let's say five for these purposes. During that time, they say that he had spoke to two Black Panthers to try to get salient information to lead to the capture of Assata Shakur. So he used two Black Panthers, which he tried to engage them in conversation to find out where she was at that time. So, and we're talking way back in 1988. So this is during the time where he was still wearing a wire for the federal government. So we have to consider the use of the wire and how they can hook you to get you to use the wire against your own people.
It is very interesting when they threw in lying to federal investigators. This is ridiculous. I mean, look at General Petraeus, who went to Congress, Oliver North, who went and blatantly lied, and none of them got indicted for lying to federal investigators. And this was to the whole Congress.
And Julian, when they say lying to the investigators, if they say you did something, all you have to say is, I didn't do it, and they say, oh, you lying, we charging you.
Oh, absolutely.
The other thing, though, I think we've got to be careful. I'm not so sure that was precisely his private practice. He was named to that position to supervise those properties by the Senate. And so he was acting official in the Senate, just like when you get a surrogate judge down at 31 Chamber Street. They're acting in official capacity that they have been appointed to do. So it's not directly their private practice.
And when you talk about the corruption in government, saying that that's the norm isn't condoning what they're doing as being appropriate. I believe it's failing our country. I believe it's failing our political system. And I think that they all should be held accountable. The real issue for me is the selectiveness in prosecuting and addressing the corruption within government. You can't have a half corrupt government and believe that it's going to work. You know, I believe from the Bloombergs to any other elected official, it should all be addressed. And when we say they just happen to be black, I don't think it just happens to be black. I think that it's intentional. I think that the way they're addressing the attack is direct, and they know exactly what they're doing.
And viewing audience, don't fall for this nonsense. Is this a referendum on black political officials? You know, because a number of black political officials have been recently arrested or accused of doing something inappropriate. You know, when white elected officials are arrested or whatever, it's never a referendum about white people. You know, but, you know, historically, the actions of a few black individuals, or I don't care if it's a lot of black individuals, however way you want to shape it, is always seen to be a representative of blacks in general.
Right, right.
So when I hear the magazines even asking that question, that's a question that a white supremacist would use to plant that idea in your head. Is this a referendum on black elected officials? It has nothing to do with black elected officials. It has everything to do with the individuals that they accuse of committing inappropriate acts.
And they intentionally want to throw a blanket.
Exactly.
And put
exactly.
that on in our heads.
Exactly.
So we can start looking at ourselves as well as they already mm-hmm. have their preconceived notions.
Right.
But we really have to be careful not to be caught up in or drawn into
exactly.
that.
Exactly.
And forget the fact that all of these things they're accused about, as they are imitating and following the white leadership.
Mm. And just want to say for the record, certainly we're pro-law enforcement. We want to see laws upheld and want to see criminals punished. However, we understand what counterintelligence is also, and we can't pretend that in interdiction of crime that there's not an element of counterintelligence in it, and the counterintelligence has always been to our detriment,
and
meaning the African Americans.
Right, and we're against selective law
exactly.
enforcement.
Exactly.
We want them to be fair.
Yeah.
And just as the New York City Police Department concentrates its stop, question, and frisk tactics on the black and Latino community, is all the law enforcement agencies in this country primarily focus its attention on members of the black and brown community. Real quick, Julian, the homeless population, it was released recently that the homeless population in New York City has increased. Now, how is that possible when we see countless numbers of 30 and 40 story condominiums being built all around Manhattan, all around Brooklyn, now downtown Brooklyn? How can we have a homeless population, arming things lovely in New York?
Well, you gotta define lovely for whom. One of the things we have to remember, when you talk about all of these new buildings and co-ops and condos being built, they're not being built for the average New Yorker. They're not being built for the black and the brown. They're being built to ensure that the those that have continue to have. Mm. And those are the ones that continue to benefit. But we have to really pay attention to our elected officials and our taxpaying dollars and make sure that they're being utilized appropriately to benefit our entire community and not just selected groups of individuals.
Well, I said it years ago, and this is redemption on my part. I said it years ago that Bloomberg's goal was to make Manhattan entirely all white and well-to-do. And there were many that disagreed with me, but where are they now?
Mm. Well, that's going to happen to Brownsville, Bed-Stuy. He may expand his objective to the entire city.
It's like a plague. It's spreading all over
Word.
This entire city.
And those of you who love the Occupy Wall Street movement, it's those Occupy Wall Street types. If you look at Bed-Stuyvesant, who's gentrifying Bed-Stuy, who initially gentrified Harlem, it's these Wall Street yuppie liberal types that are invading these communities and forcing long-term citizens out. So, you can consider some folks to be your friends if you want to, but open up your eyes and see what's really happening. All right, my producer is telling me we have to go to the phones. I see you, Nat. First caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where are you calling from?
Tap.
Yes, where are you calling from, caller?
Hello?
You're on the air. Where are you calling from?
Hello?
All right, next caller. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop.
You, gentlemen?
Where you calling from, caller? All right, can you hear us, caller? All right, we might be having a little problem with our phone call, so we ask our phone callers to hold on a second and listen to your phone, so when we say welcome, don't listen to your TV, talk via the telephone, because there's a slight delay.
Mike didn't have too many disagreeing with that in terms of white community. I've been saying for umpteen number of years that the idea is to make Manhattan, particularly in the city next, as a gated community for rich white folks.
Well, I said it, and there was disagreement. I just said, where are they now? I said it, and there was disagreement.
But, you see the so-called black and brown community basically being eliminated. I mean, when they are being pushed out of Harlem, because of high rent prices, soon the law they're going to be pushed off the northern regions of northern Manhattan. But let's see if our phone calls are up at this time. First caller, welcome to Community Cop. Are you on the air?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
Okay, where you calling from?
You hear me?
Yes. Where you calling from, caller?
I'm calling from Mississippi, New York.
All right. Quick question or comment, caller?
Can he be a little more specific?
Okay, now, what I'm trying to say, what we were talking about, stop and frisk, that's where whites can walk anywhere they want. They feel free. They know their gun is down. They do everything, like I called before. You got skinheads walking around with guns and all that, and we're unprotected. And that scumbag mayor, this is, like you said, what he wants, a all-white city of New York City, Mississippi.
All right. Thank you, brother. Thank you for your call. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where are you calling from? Next caller, you on the air?
Yes, hello. Can you hear me?
Yes, where are you calling from?
Hello? Hello?
All right, where are you calling from, caller?
Yes, I'm calling from the Village of Harlem.
Okay, quick question or comment.
Okay, I just want to say that Alumbe Brass is going to be honored at the Harriet Tubman School on Saturday. That's 127th Street, around noontime.
No, 4 o'clock.
Honoring Alumbe Brass. And what I want to know, and I want to ask the panel, is this. We realize that a lot of the white politicians are stealing and whatnot, but at least when they do it, it's like a Bernie Madoff type thing, where they're not just stealing a watermelon off the plantation. They rip you off for everything. And you remember Willie the Actor Sutton, when they asked him, why does he rob banks? He said, because that's where the money is.
That's right.
So, I mean, like people like Jesse Jackson and Jr. and his wife, they get busted for ripping off nickel and dime. Then you have the other Kwame, who was the mayor of Detroit. Mm-hmm. And now you have this Samson. So, it's sad, because I remember when I was a kid, you had Hewlett Jack, who was representing the community, and they busted him for $5,000, which is peanuts. So, where does this stop? I mean, do we put a stop to it? Because when I think Big Mike was saying that the baddest guy he mentioned was this gentleman from a few centuries. I think
one of
the baddest brothers is Father Lucas. Mm-hmm. So the work that this man has been doing, even Malcolm X said that, if you read the autobiography of Malcolm X, he mentions him. He said, there's a Catholic priest who's more militant than me. Mm. He's talking about Father Lucas, if you read the book. Mm. So let's give the props while these brothers are still here on the planet. Right. You know, I love you, and there's nothing you can do about it. Keep the faith, Father.
Okay. Thank you, brother. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. And don't forget, the event is at 4 o'clock for Alumbe Brass. Not 12, it's at 4 o'clock this Saturday.
And the address is 250 West 127th Street.
Okay.
Between Adam Clayton Powell and Frederick Douglass.
All right, now Julian on that? This is going
Saturday.
Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where you calling from? Next caller, you're on the air. Where you calling from?
Hello.
Yes, where you calling from, caller? Don't listen to your TV. Listen to your phone. All right.
Hello.
Where you calling from, caller? All right, next caller. We might be having a little problem with our phones this week.
Hello.
All right, don't listen to your TV, caller. Listen to your phone. All right, give it to that caller, please. Give it to that caller. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where you calling from? All right. Caller, yeah, some of them may not be able to hear us. Are you there, caller? All right, for some reason, they may not be able to hear us. I'm forcing callers. We might be having we're having some technical difficulty. We'll try to work it out. But getting back to some of the topics we discussed that some of us didn't really get it. We actually didn't talk about it. Stop questioning the frisk numbers. Julian, there's a report stating that the numbers are down. That's the documented numbers.
And that's exactly the point, is the documented numbers. We can even talk about the numbers being down. Let's say the numbers are down. We want the numbers to stop for illegal.
Exactly.
Stop question and frisk. You know, if the number goes down to from 800,000 to 700,000, there's still 700,000 too many illegal stop question and frisk. So let's talk about doing away with it.
Right. All right, let's see if we have a caller. Caller, are you on the line? Do we have a caller on the line? All right, we're still having problems with our phone calls. But Julian, you name an excellent point, because some would suggest, and language is very important, some would suggest that this is improvement. Mm-hmm. And Malcolm X one time made the analogy that if you stick somebody in the back with a 12-inch knife and you pull a knife out 4 inches, that's not progress. You know what I'm saying? You have to pull the knife all the way out, and then you have to heal the wound. Mm-hmm. That's progress. So we're right. not swayed in any way, shape, or form. If it went down from 800,000 documented stops to 200,000 documented stops, that's not improvement. That's not progress. Progress is only when the legal stops and question and frisk completely end. Yeah.
And I wish that when this being discussed, that people use the same terms that we use. The illegal
exactly.
stop, question and frisk.
Very important. Because all stop, question and frisk are illegal. Some of them are justified. Mm-hmm. Any comments?
Well, no, I think that's true. But I want to be very careful when I even talk about the justified one, because there has to be some reasonable reason for
right.
stopping anybody.
Right. And that's what we're talking about. Yeah. That's what we define yeah. justified
right. stuff. Yeah, mm-hmm. But then whose statistics are you going to believe? Ray Kelly and his deputy commissioner for lying,
Paul Brown?
Paul Brown?
Well, the original numbers were obscene. At best, so an improvement on obscene is what? Absurd, so it doesn't matter.
All right, let's try again. Next phone caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where are you calling from?
Yes, hello, my name is Michael, and I'm calling from the Village of Harlem.
Okay, Hotep.
And I'd like to give a shout-out to the brothers on the panel, as well as my Uncle Eugene. I have a poem that I wrote for you brothers, and I'm going to try to deliver it to you at that event on Saturday. And so, keep up the good work, and God bless you.
Hold on a second, brother. Are you still there?
No. All
right, we must have lost him. I was going to say, if it wasn't long, he said now. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where you calling from?
Hello, hi. How you doing?
Yes, where you calling from, caller? Hello? No, all right, next caller. Next caller, welcome.
Hello?
Yes, where you calling from, caller?
You lost me.
Where you calling from? All right, we'll try one more. Next caller, welcome to Community Cop. Where you calling from? All right, yes, we're having, we apologize. We're trying to get you in. We're having some technical difficulty on our phone. We'll try to work it out. Our producer's running back and forth to the phone lines. We see you out there, caller, so we know you're there, but there's some, evidently there's some problem with you hearing when we request that you state your comment. So back to the subject, the community council has once again stated Christine Quinn. Of course, she's like Christopher Columbus. He's discovered this stop, question, and frisk issue late after 12 years of being in the office. She's now talking about appointing an inspector general after millions and millions of black, innocent black Latino have been stopped, questioned, and frisked, arrested, you know. She's like Christopher Columbus.
Yeah, lost. But, you know, that inspector general thing, that's a gig, too.
Exactly.
Because if he's going to be, he, she, or it, is going to be subject to the, what you call it, appointed by Bloomberg.
The mayor, right.
What difference is it going to make?
Who and stating that Bloomberg is in full support of illegal stop, question, and frisk.
Of course.
Okay.
And the fact is, this is coming from someone who said she's a Kelly person, and that she loved the work that Kelly was doing, supported his work, and would admonish anybody in the city council who spoke out against Kelly. So how could she now, that's a conflict of terms for her to say she has a problem with stop questioning Fritz, yet she highlights and elevates Kelly to enormous levels. So it doesn't make sense. And this is the same person, of course, who said she loves Reverend Sharpton because he never refuses her anything. So you figure it out.
So does that mean her position is a political ploy?
Mm. Mm-hmm. I think that's an understatement. I think anyone who does not connect these illegal stop, question, and frisk to Police Commissioner Kelly is blind. For her support of Commissioner Kelly and her alleged criticism of these stop, question, and frisk practices should be criticized and critiqued by any intelligent member of our community. Christine Quinn has done nothing, absolutely nothing, as it relates to stop, question, and frisk for her entire tenure as a speaker in the city council.
And as you would normally say, she's not blind because she sees
exactly
what's going on.
Exactly.
You know,
she approaches stop and frisk the same way our congressional figures looked at Katrina. Mm. They watched Katrina happen, said nothing to Bush 43. They should have put papers, you know, obviously, papers to have him removed from office. even though they by themselves, 40 people, cannot do that. They should have at least attempted it to show that they stand together, show that they care and they're concerned about the black folks in Louisiana. They didn't do that. This is what they were put in office to do, to stand up and represent us, not the other people. Represent us. They failed to do it, just like in the city council. They refused to represent us, and that's why we're led by white minority rule in this city, the same way across the country we're led by white majority rule.
It's very interesting, the majority of the city council are people of color, and it's very interesting too that, if I'm not mistaken, the name, his name just slipped me, that the mayor of Louisiana during the time of Katrina is under indictment himself.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
And one of the most, you know, Mike, you brought up Katrina. Brothers and sisters, you can't make this stuff up. If you look at the investigation that happened after the events of Katrina, when they were talking about the killings and the rapes that was happening in the Superdome, when they talk about the violent mayhem.
Houston Superdome.
No, the New Orleans Dome.
Right.
They were saying there was rapes, there was murders happening in the Dome. While they found all that was false, that was lies, that was made up. And even the mayor himself, when he called, when he out of outrage, called for the National Guards and called for a system, there wasn't a crime problem. They have done analysis on the amount of people that were murdered, on reports that people that were raped, and they can't even find no reports. All of this, you know, when you look at the violent, the contemptible hatred that the white media has against the African-American community, because they were the ones that were reporting these unsubstantiated reports. I was just reading a report to say all that was lies that was going on, all the accusations that were saying, you know, that was occurring in New Orleans, the gang shootings and all of that, was lies, was made up, and it was unsubstantiated, but it doesn't take anything for the white media to make these violent attacks against members of the black community.
I'm sorry, I gotta say this. I just have to say this.
A vein popping out of my head. Is that what you want to say, brother?
Brother, I see it, but I'm not gonna say that because I understand how you feel, brother. Uh-huh. But the only response is black nationalism.
Exactly.
When you allow the white media to tell your story, to create a story that is only to the detriment of your community, and we sit back and we allow our families and friends to be defiled by lies, we have to respond by utilizing black nationalism. Mm. We have to control our own media.
Right.
We have to control our own police, our own educational system, our own everything that exists in our community. Until then, we will be subjected to the lies and the hatred of white supremacy.
And our own elected officials, because at that time, the black mayor, quote, went along with the program. Mm.
Mm. Well, look, the black media, well, the white media, because everything is white media. If it's not so-called black media, everything, it doesn't call itself white, but obviously it is.
Right.
The Post, the Times that attacked Adam Clayton Powell and others and all of them, ABC, NBC, CBS, they're all white media.
Is that mainstream media?
When you say mainstream media, that's just a cover for white media.
That's synonymous. You know, it's the same thing.
So the thing is, they the ones who said that the governor, you know, Governor Patterson, was having sex in the closet of his office.
Mm.
They're the ones that said that these baseball tickets were somehow criminal for him to be sitting there front row at a Yankee playoff game. I mean, they made up all these situations about him, whether it was drug related, whether it was affairs across the Hudson. They said all these things and organized blacks, well, they were all taking orders. Blacks elected officials were taking orders from whites, and they called meetings to have the governor step down. So I'm just saying that it's not only the media as a significant part of it, but the media, along with people who want to control the budget, along with elected officials, it's moving parts. It's a situation with a lot of moving parts, but when you can isolate it or put it all under one tent, you see that it's commonly called white supremacy.
Well, it's very interesting, too, that you mentioned, because I couldn't care less where he was having sex. The thing is, to get him on the tickets for the, World Series.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
And Giuliani was living off this. Mm-hmm. Giuliani had any time he wanted, he could bring friends.
Mm.
You know, but it was all right. Giuliani had the right color.
And you have to look at the nexus. You have to look at how the media is connected to the elected officials who are disseminating this information and making sure that information is being put out there. There's a connection. You know, we have to connect the dots. And unfortunately, sometimes they want us, as Noel talks about, you know, the sleight of hands. Mm-hmm. You're talking about the smoke and mirrors. Mm-hmm. You know, they want us to look in one direction. But meanwhile, the strings and the controls are being controlled from the opposite side of the room.
And the most dangerous instrument that some of us have in our home is the television. You know, the television communicates so many lies, so many deceptions. It fills out people. I know, you know, some of us are unaware with these misconceptions about ourselves, about them, about the world. There's so much lies being instilled into our consciousness and our subconsciousness. Our information is so incorrect so that when we make an analysis, it's a wrong analysis. And that's why it's very important. We have to start using the language, because language is very important. It is the white media. It's not the media. When you just call it the media, you don't understand the source, who's behind it. So when they give you information, you think it's legitimate, unbiased information. But it's not unbiased information. It's reporting with an objective. It's reporting with an opinion. And they're instituting their opinion into your consciousness, so you accept their consciousness as being fact. The New York Post, Channel 7, where is the black media? I mean, they just recently shortened Kiss FM from 2 hours to 1 hour. They took off, what's the brother they took off the air, who did the
Michael Baisley?
Michael Baisley. Right. Mm-hmm. The objective is to eliminate a black opinion.
Right. And whenever you find anyone in the media, and they don't have to be part of mainstream media, but when they start talking a black opinion and a black objective, you find that at some point they are removed from
right.
that position.
Right.
You know, and even the ones who are being supported financially by white corporations, they tone down how they disseminate the information that needs to get to our community. It's always toned down.
Well, literally, there's really no real black press now as we knew it in years gone by. There's no real black TV shows where the information is delivered to the black community, serious information.
Right.
You know, that's just a thing of the past.
Other than the final call.
Other than, we have the final call, but we need more of that.
Right.
We used to have Black News.
That's right.
We used to have Tony Brown's Journal,
that's
like
right.
it is. So many others. I mean, McQuarrie Report.
Mm-hmm.
So many others. It's all gone. And we used to have various radio stations that was the drum that could organize our community in one day and have thousands of people out in the street. That's all gone now. The few that's left, they're so in bed with the corporations, they censor who white folks censor. If white folks say that Dr. Collins was an enemy, black talk treated him as an enemy. Where could he go to lay his head? Where could he go to earn a dollar? They look, black folks, if you go back to the Montgomery bus boycott and you look at the role Rosa Parks played, after that, they didn't even employ her. She couldn't even get a job anywhere, and yet they employed four women as secretaries and with other various duties in the Montgomery Improvement Association, but they didn't hire Rosa Parks, who initiated it. She had to leave the state of Alabama. She went to Virginia, couldn't get hired there, went to Detroit, couldn't get hired there. It took a long time before Whatchacallem eventually did give her a job. What's the congressman from Detroit?
Yeah, we said a couple of weeks ago.
His name, I mentioned his name. But, but I'm just saying, so black folks treat you the way white folks do, because if you an enemy, if you're so-called controversial in white circles, the black folks who want to be in the bed with white folks, they treat you the same way. So it's whether Dr. Collins, Rosa Parks, Malcolm, Adam Clayton Powell, and others, they treat you the same way.
Yeah, right. Wait a minute, Michael, are you saying that Rosa Parks, who's allegedly heralded by the NAACP, that was stopped by whites, and that used to funnel information as it relates to their membership to the FBI
right.
back then, and was really an organization that was created to sort of neutralize Marcus Garvey, United Negro Improvement Association, which was the most progressive black nationalist organization of his day. Are you saying that this NAACP, National Association of Advancement of Colored Folk, would not hire somebody that they claim they herald, that she couldn't even get a job with them?
She couldn't get a job anywhere in black America.
Mm.
She was waiting on tables, and she was educated, highly educated, well-spoken, and she was waiting on tables as a bus girl.
Mm.
I think you were trying to remember Ron Dillums.
No, not Dillums, not Dillums from Houston. I'm talking about what's his name from Detroit. He's still around to this day. He's very elderly
right.
now. Forgot his name, but...
Oh, you're right.
And he employed her.
Yeah, he eventually employed her, but that was later in life. But like I said, if you just to state that you have to leave Alabama and you go to Virginia, you couldn't get nothing in Virginia. You have to move on to Detroit, go back and forth, crisscross the country several times till you finally get a job. And she did demeaning work like waiting on tables as a waiter, the great Rosa Parks. So black folks who want to be in all on the same page with white folks, that's why they do these destructive, disgusting things and censorship, because they want to be in bed with white folks.
I just have to ask Noel a question.
Yes, sir.
What would be the response to that? What's the response to her not being able to get a job, not be able to find employment in any white establishment or any black establishment that's controlled by white folks? How would we respond to that?
Black nationalism.
Oh, okay. I just wanted to
the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said it best.
That's right.
He said, accept your own and be yourself.
And Marcus, you know, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, who took the role, the example of Marcus Garvey, said, listen, man, we have to create our own businesses. We have to create our own organizations, so we won't have to rely on anybody for a job. We have to create our own newspapers, our own television stations, our own hospitals, so we don't have to rely on anyone for ourselves. But I'm sorry, we have to close, and I really apologize to our phone callers. Let me say real quick, don't forget the People's Film Festival, organized by our producer, Veronica Kitt, May 30th to June 2nd. Julian.
Listen, you know, my response is always black nationalism. You know, we really have to deal with this political issue. There's a mayoral race coming up. And we really have to be attentive to what's going on. Dad, I love you. Be the family. Our blessings are with you. Reinstate Alton Maddox.
Prayers for Alambe Brad. Reinstate Alton Maddox. He will be speaking at your college Thursday.
Father.
We're going to have a hell of a fight ahead.
Little more, I love you. See you next Tuesday. Thank you for that. Wood, Veronica Kiss, Yellow Berry.
So while there's moonlight and music and love and romance, let's face the music and dance.